opportunity to be who you've called us to be and to embrace your process. In the 2019 Masterclass, the break we had, we thank you for the opportunity to be back on track. And for the 5 courses remaining before we finish in November, we look up to you that by your grace, you will enable us to process through all, that in understanding of the truth in your word will set us free. We sanctify ourselves to continue to study. We sanctify the day. We sanctify the airwaves. Have your way, sovereign ruler of the universe. Let your name be exalted in our everyday choices, in our everyday lives. At the end of the day, let your name be honored and glorified. Holy Spirit, take over now. In Yeshua Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. And brothers and sisters, we thank the Father that we've had a short break. And for those of you who were behind, we believe some have already covered up or are substantially covered up. And for those who were up to date, you had a needed rest, almost 3 weeks, you know, in which you had time to catch your breath and refresh yourself. Now we come to a place where we continue. There are 5 more courses. We finished 7 courses. There are 5 more courses ahead of us between now and end of November. And by the grace of our Father, we hope to be able to cover all of them to make sure that everything we ought to do, we do. Today, we're going to be starting course 118. Course 118 is the call, cost, and reward of discipleship. The call, cost, and reward of discipleship. Today, I'll be presenting a summary of 2 lessons. And, you know, tomorrow, our principal officers and our mentors will take over and teach Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. Then on Saturday, Pastor Grace will broadcast Digging Deep, because there are still so much ground to cover. On Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday next week, our mentors and principal officers will continue. And then on Thursday next week, I'll resume. And so we're going to take a short time out, and we're going to give you briefings later. Because of sensitive nature of the location, we'll say more other than that, because it's not just a time out, it's also a time of spiritual warfare and prophetic intercession over some critical areas that the world that the Lord needs a touch of grace to rest upon. And so keep us in prayer from tomorrow till Wednesday next week, when we'll finish the assignment and we'll return. We'll share with you some of things the Lord will have us do. Okay, today, let's go on to talk about the call, cost, and reward of discipleship. Lesson 1, the prologue. All over the world, men and brethren, Christianity seems to be busting at the seams. You know, you go to all over the world, you see that today over 2.5 billion people on earth claim to be Christians. Wow, such a large number. Billion, 2.5. Unfortunately, there's not much fruit in terms of their impact on the world around. You know, somebody once told the church in a nation that Christianity is a mile wide and an inch deep. And that best describes the situation where we have churchianity busting at the seams. Even in advanced societies like America, United Kingdom, as well as third world nations like Nigeria, it is not uncommon to see thousands and tens of thousands of people, even hundreds of thousands, gathered in a specific location to worship. Unfortunately, there is not much positive impact of that large presence, you know, on their societies, on the communities where they are. You know, it's just all about people driving across into a building, into a location, into a compound, after which they drive away. And the neighboring environment is still in the mess it was before the church was planted there. So it's obviously, you know, it's obvious that something is essentially wrong. Something is wrong with a situation where there are so many people who are supposedly connected with the King of Kings, the head of the kingdom, but they do not reflect his nature. They do not reflect his lifestyle. They do not reflect his kingdom in their day-to-day activities, you know. And so what is happening today is that many people are bringing reproach to the name of the Lord, even though they claim to be Christians in their places of work. If others steal, they steal. In their general lifestyle, what others do, they do. No difference. Nothing. Nothing you can distinguish. The only thing is hallelujah. The only thing is songs they sing. The only thing is the words of their mouth. In real life situation, there's no more difference. So something is wrong. And the core problem the Father has shown over the years is that modern versions of Christian religion have been promoting a twisted version of the Great Commission. That twisted version is a version which appeals to the pristine elements of human nature. It's a version in which there's a gospel that is about coming to receive blessings. It's about coming to take what is in the hand of Elohim without being concerned about his heart. So people seek his hand and not his heart. They don't seek his hand, not his face. And it's a kind of worship. We call it the utilitarian gospel. Utilitarian gospel where we twist worship from us existing according to Revelation 4:11, existing for the pleasure of Elohim, for his good pleasure, existing for his pleasure to worship him, to adore him in spite of, according to what he said there in that chapter 4 of Revelation verse 11, twisting it to mean that Elohim exists to meet our needs. And so today, all the church hopping is because people are busy looking for their needs. So if this woman of God cannot meet it, they go to the next one. They watch the sleek commercials on television and they are attracted to where they think the solution is. When church is about needs of people, there's a twist. So rather than existing for us to worship him, us existing to worship Elohim, he is now existing to solve our problem. And that approach to problem-solving churchianity is the heart of why Christians are unable and unwilling to pay the price required. Amen and brethren, this is something that the Lord is not happy with. So this utilitarian gospel is flourishing across the world. People are gathering unto men, not unto Elohim. They are gathering unto churches, not Elohim. Many are in church, they don't know him who is their head. They don't know him because they never bother to say, what is it that pleases him? What is it that excites him? What is it that he requires them to make in terms of adjustment? And so, men and brethren, what the Lord wants us to do in this course is to go back to the basics to discover what ought to be the preoccupation of those who say they have come to Yeshua. What is the great process? What is it the Lord required of them? And this course is going to address this thing systematically. And we trust the Lord that you all who will receive this word, you won't brush it aside. You won't think it's for another person. You check up your life. Have you come to the place where you understand what we are talking about in this lesson? And the sweet thing is that the book on this course is already available on the website www.kingdombookclub.com. You see the call, cost, and reward of discipleship. And I want to say this to those of you who are doing Global School of Ministry in various nations or you're running a center. All the books on the website are the courses of the Global School of Ministry. The Masterclass and Global School of Ministry, they have the same courses. The only difference is the Masterclass is when Pastor Grace and I, by the grace of the Lord and by His Spirit, are directly teaching people. The materials are the same. The curriculum is the same. And not only teaching people, we take a segment, a selection of courses Holy Spirit leads us to. It could be 12, as in this year, or any other number. And when we check it and by the Spirit break it down, that's a masterclass. The Global School of Ministry is even more extensive. It's when you do either all the courses or as many as the overseer of the ministry or pastor deems necessary to empower people. And if it does a portion, the people who are empowered, even if they're ordained, they continue to do it until they finish the entire curriculum of 41 courses. So men and brethren, the course objectives. This course will take us through the core of the gospel of the kingdom. Matthew 24:14, and this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then the end shall come. So as we study, our Heavenly Father will use the revelation to draw the mind of the church back to an ancient landmark. What is the ancient landmark? The cornerstone of the gospel. What is it? Discipleship. Yeshua didn't come to found a religion and compete with so-and-so person for how many people, who has more people. You know, the people of the world like to do comparison. Oh, Christianity is this billion. Islam is that billion. Hinduism is that billion. This is that billion. That's religion for you. Yeshua is not in any competition or comparison with any human. He created all things. All things were created for his pleasure. The gospel is about making disciples of Yeshua in all nations of the earth. It's not about gathering a crowd of milk-drinking humans around human beings, around so-called anointed preachers, around so-called churches for their spiritual and emotional and physical sustenance. It is not about building huge physical structures or building the images of success of people and then projecting that image of success by the wristwatch you wear, the label of the shirt you wear, the label of the cufflink you wear, the label of the shoe you wear, so that people see as a symbol of success and they are drawn to you. If the gospel you preach is one where people are drawn to you, you are simply creating an idolatrous system. Everyone in ministry has an assignment to emulate John the Baptist, to deliberately decrease that Yeshua may increase, to point people to him so that people will go to encounter him and go to meet him and go to be processed by him. Men and brethren, the gospel is about making disciples of Yeshua of all nations of the earth. He has sent us to make disciples. That's why in clear language, he said this to his people in Matthew 28, if you are his, he says it to you. Verse 18, and Yeshua came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Let's stop there for a moment before we go on to the next verse. You know, following his death and resurrection, as we know, all power in heaven and on earth has been restored back to him. You know, he shed his glory and had to come to earth as an earthling for 3.5 years. And then he went to the cross as a Lamb of Elohim. And when he went to the cross and was crucified, he seemed to be helpless, hanging there. But he was paying the price, and he was buried. The third day, he rose again by the power of the Holy Spirit. And as he rose again, all power in heaven and on earth restored to him, that at his name every knee should bow. And he said to us, before he told us the Great Commission, he said, listen, I'm the one sending you. I'm the spring and circumference of all authority and all power. And so if it is so, then rely on me who is sending you. And then what next did he say? Verse 19, go ye therefore and teach all nations. This is the Great Commission. The Great Commission is not go and carry beautiful music, carry popular musicians, gather a crowd and wazzle them up and make them feel good and say, oh, a great man of God has come, plaster his picture all over the town, put his billboard, his Photoshop face all over the town. No, the Great Commission in verse 19, go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, of the Son, of the Holy Spirit. Men and brethren, it's about go ye or go forth. It's not come here. It's not gather people unto the man preaching. It's not gather people into a building or into an organization to join a religious organization. Is go ye to find the people where they are. Go ye to locate them where they are. And then number two, he said, teaching them to observe all things. It's about teaching. The new covenant Yahweh offers to mankind in Yeshua is the gospel of the kingdom. It is not one where you skim the water on the surface and skim milk. No, it requires skillful application of the principles and culture of the kingdom in the world, because the world, kingdom culture is in the world. It is now to take that, to tell people how the Father wants us to live, how he wants us to relate with him and with all people, the manner of life, the attitude of life, the mindset, the thought process, everything to the point where whatever is in our worldly ways of thinking, the American way, the African way, the European way, the Asian way, the culture of the kingdom in the Holy Scriptures is used skillfully as a sword of the Spirit, as a water that washes away, as a mirror that shows what is inside, to chalk out all the junk that is inside. And then our mind is filled with the mind of Yeshua, which is in the Holy Scriptures, for Him and the Scriptures are one. In other words, in a gospel where teaching is effected, it's about transforming people, renew mind, transform hearts, change people from inside out, take away the old and bring in the new. And the new is to engraft Yeshua into people to the degree that they are His temple, through which, dwelling by His Spirit, He now shows forth in their thought, in their words, in their deeds, in their attitudes, in all situations. So you don't switch Him on inside a building to switch Him off at work. You don't switch Him on inside a building to switch Him off at in the home. You don't switch Him off on at inside the building. Then in the environment where you are, you switch off and be like other people. No. Those who accept the call to discipleship and those who are disciple makers is a serious business of using the word. So it's not just go and preach to people and titillate them and make them feel excited and give them stories about a miracle Jesus will do for them and all that. He still does miracles, mighty miracles, mountain moving miracles. He still does them, but he says, don't go and talk about the miracles. Go and talk about the demand He places on everybody that I stand at the door and knock. If you open, I'll come in and sup with you. I want to be one with you. So that's what He says. And then in verse 20, He says, teaching them to observe all things, whatsoever I command you, I learn with you always to the end of the world. Amen. Now He says, go and teach them all things. Discipleship is the skillful application of the word by those who are already disciples, with which they enable everyone they meet to take the word seriously, to embrace the word. And the word is engrafted in, and the word begins to rule every department of life. Men and brethren, this is something serious. The Lord wants us to get back to that business. If you see us in this commission seem to be word-based, morning, afternoon, night, it's simply because the Lord has shown us that the way to get the church perfected is by the word. The ministry of the word, Holy Spirit breathing upon the word, the breath of life, opening eyes. Like yesterday and on Thursday, we began the series on marriage from a kingdom, marriage and family life from a kingdom culture perspective. And I urge you to go and check the tape yesterday, where we talk about 10 pillars of kingdom marriage, and the Thursday where we began. You know what it means? There is kingdom culture in every department of life. And so the Lord is saying, don't switch me on and off. I'm more than that. Don't. Let the word transform you. The word is still able to do that. And then Yeshua said, I'm with you always, 24/7. Even to the end of the age. I am with you. If you go to do this work, I'm with you. We are to disciple nations. We are to change worldly culture and transform, it by kingdom culture that goes as a catalyst. Hidden. And the catalyst does the work from inside out. But you know what? How can you change a nation? You start with a person at a time. You start with a group at a time. So if you have only one person as a Christian, the Lord has given to you one person, pour Yeshua into that person. Pour the word into that person. Challenge that person to come to the place where he makes the valid decision that he can't live life for himself. She can't live life for herself. It takes time. It takes process. It's slow cook. This is not McDonald's. This is not KFC. This is not drive-by. This is not drive-through. This is not microwave. This is slow cook process. It takes time. It could take years. And I'll tell you, there is an instantaneous dimension and there's a process dimension. You know what? We're going to come to all that in this learning. But the Lord said there has to be a day when you realize that you can't live for yourself. You cannot continue to live for yourself. You cannot just be hopping from church to church, from man of God to woman of God, from demon possessed, from spirit possessed people, all just looking for that miracle, looking for that blessing, looking for that. And the days are going by. You don't know what will happen. You don't know when it will come. And the Lord is saying there has to come a time when you realize that life does not consist on the abundance of things you have. What shall it profit if you can gain the whole world and lose your own soul? The Lord is calling us. So in this course, we will trust the Father to make his heart plain on the subject matter. The need arises to understand with clarity, therefore, the kind of relationship Yeshua expects from his own. It is not casual. It is solid. Men and brethren, he told us in John 10:10, the thief, Satan, cometh not but for to steal, to kill, to destroy. But I am come that they might have life and have it more abundantly. What is this abundant life? How is it attained? It is not attained by what a man or woman of God told you. A lot of people are building their faith on their relationship with a man or woman of God. And they have all been most miserable. They are actually far away from the king, because unknown to them, if you build your faith on a man and a man is ruling your life, you are codependent on that one, you may not necessarily know him. That's why he tells us in John 15, abide in me, not in the man of God, not in the woman of God, abide in me and I in you. If you abide in him, then the sap, which is Holy Spirit, can take the life of Yeshua to seep into you, and you can see yourself growing from grace to grace. Things that used to destabilize you no more. Things that used to bring you down no more. Things that used to tickle you, they tickle you no more, because you come to a place where you are no longer a fair weather Christian. You are no longer one who is just drinking milk from people, tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine. You come to a place where you know that you are his and he is yours. He is your Lord. He is your Savior. He is your King. He rules your life. You are under his sovereign rule. Men and brethren, therefore, the course synopsis, we're going to cover these things in the course. Number one, the call to discipleship of Yeshua, not membership of denominations, is the prime need of the church in our generation. We're going to, number two, define what a call to discipleship is. Number three, in what ways and with what language did Yeshua make a demand on his followers? We're going to examine them. You know, number four, what process does Elohim expect believers to undergo to be who he wants them to be? Number five, how does acceptance of the call of Yeshua affect our previous relationships? Number six, what are the rewards the king promises those who pay the price to follow him? And if you will receive these things, we'll therefore ask you that there will be a few review questions. Number one, from your perspective of the lesson today, what is authentic discipleship? What is it about? The one you have to model anywhere and everywhere. What is it about? Two, what is the supernatural assignment all believers share? And how does it affect you? And just take those two basically, you know. And we're going to go on to the second lesson for today so that we can lay a foundation for the brethren to build up. The director of studies is going to be giving information to all the principal officers and mentors who will be on the class during this week. So let's now go on to talk about what the Lord wants us to do in lesson 2. Now, during a mission to pray over one of the major religious cities in the world, to pray over its religious altars, including the high place of Christian religion, the very high place, we saw with our spiritual and natural eyes how the personal relationship gospel, which came to the city from Jerusalem and Antioch, was effectively substituted with a religious system. And this dead religious system has two pillars on which it rests. Number one, the first is this: personal relationship with Elohim was jettisoned for a system where people are primarily members of a physical church. So instead of the gospel that Yeshua gave, where people are in personal relationship with the Father through him, in the 4th century, the gospel was changed. So instead of personal relationship, all you now need to do is be a member of a organization, a religious organization. Men and brethren, with a physical location, a building, okay, we're going to come to that. So this is the root of denominationalism, because if you join an organization, your identity is now the organization, no longer Yeshua. You see, if you are in Yeshua and grow in him, he can plant you in a congregation. So that's a different paradigm. But if your basic identity now is to the organization you join, so-and-so church, your pride is in it, your glory is in it, and that's what gives you identity and gives you meaning, automatically, that's the denominationalism that is projected. Now, denominationalism is a critical enemy of the Most High. 23 years ago, the Lord delivered this vessel from denominationalism because it divides his church into pockets. Then when people are comfortable with membership of a church over and above their personal walk with Yahweh, they acquire a false sense of security. Security based on observance of religious routine and rituals, which act as a sop to the human conscience, is very deadly. The people are thus programmed to see loyalty to their physical church as superior to their loyalty to King Yeshua, their Redeemer, who is supposedly distant in heaven. Because that's what happened today. When people go to church, within the group, within being the face of the man or woman of God, they act differently. At home, they act differently. Why? Because this church that they are a member of and this man or woman of God they are close to is more proximate. They can see them. They forget the omniscience of Elohim. So that switching on and off creates a very terrible disconnect. Number two thing, the second pillar is that those who are in the physical church have no vibrant personal relationship with him. You know what will happen? They will now need mediators between them and Yahweh. They will need people who hear from him. They will need people who are closer to him. And they now unconsciously make themselves grandsons of Elohim. As you know, Elohim has no grandson. All of us are children of the Most High, both the leaders and the led. We are all children of the Most High. But when people have no personal relationship with him and are members of churches, are connected to a man or woman of God, they automatically make him a mediator. So instead of Yeshua, the mediator with the Father, they now have another mediator in the human leader. This is the origin of the apostate priestly case system. The priestly case system whereby men of God are anointed, they are closer to Elohim, they hear from him, and people come to church to consume whatever they tell them. And the result of this situation is that the word of the priest is authoritative and accepted without question, since the people are shielded from knowing the Bible themselves. And that's why the Lord wants us to be like the saints of Berea, that Paul the apostle, after he preaches, they search the scripture. We've told you several times, as a matter of accountability, whatever Pastor Grace and I teach you, go and study the word. All the scripture references, study it. If you spot anything out of sync, draw our attention. We'll be the first to apologize on this forum. Because this is his work. This is assignment. And we will never tell you whether you like it or not, take it. No. If anything we share with you doesn't sync with the scriptures, doesn't align with the Holy Scriptures, draw our attention. It's your right. Men and brethren, it's so important that we escape the manipulation going on where the word of man is trumping the word of the Lord. Are you not seeing ministers today encouraging people to break their marriages and to be remarried by them? What will you tell the Lord on the last day? That you are in perpetual adultery. What will you tell the Lord if his word says you are in adultery? And what are you going to tell me? You are telling me you're okay with what you are because a man of God told you it's okay. What shall we say of what is happening? The mess today. The mess where people are manipulated and they are no longer. This is what happened to Israel. This is how Israel missed it. Israel missed it when Israel began to make its own way. And they left aside the things of the Father. Go to Romans chapter 9 and Romans chapter 10, 1 to 5, and see how Israel made its own religious system. So Yeshua is reforming his church, brethren. And part of that process is to empower saints with the right information, which will lead them to have a vibrant personal relationship with him. And flowing from that personal relationship, they are taken through a process which will enable them to enjoy intimate fellowship through Holy Spirit indwelling in them. He begins to lead them and guide them. As many as are led by Holy Spirit, they are the sons of Elohim. Men and brethren, the Lord wants us to come to that place where we can enjoy intimate relationship as Holy Spirit leads us into the mind of the Father. And from that standpoint, we proceed to hear and respond to his call to service, because disciples don't stop there. They are called to grow, to become able ministers of the New Testament. So it is not the will of Yahweh that any should perish. Anyone who Yeshua died for, the Father doesn't want any to perish. And so he also doesn't want us to come and say we are saved and grow. I mean, and be stifled and stay there. No, the Lord has made it clear to us that we must be careful. The great tragedy today in the household of faith is that many people who are supposedly in ministry, what happened to them? They got born again. And because they heard about the baptism of the Holy Spirit, the power of the Holy Spirit, they converted it, they prayed for it, they were baptized in the Holy Spirit. They saw gifts of the Lord. They saw gifts of the Holy Spirit in their life. But unfortunately, something that happens is this, that they were not able to know that without being disciples, they're in danger. So when the Lord said in the book of Matthew, chapter 7. Let's read that place. Matthew chapter 7. Men and brethren, we need to know that these are not all false prophets. Matthew chapter 7, from verse 13. It says, "Enter ye in the straight gate. For wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be which go in thereat. Because straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it." Now, if you go on, where it says, "You shall know them by their fruits, not by their works." And many will come to him that day and say, "I did this miracle, I did that miracle, I did that miracle." He said to them, "I didn't know you." Some of it are people who, they were just saved. They just grabbed the power of the Holy Spirit, began to do things. Before you know it, they used the power of the Holy Spirit to grow their own kingdoms, their own empires, make money, and their God is their belly. They never gave Elohim a chance to process them. The result is, they grow outside him. They do the signs and wonders, yes, because the name of Yeshua is powerful in itself. But because they were not disciples, they didn't allow themselves to become disciples of Yeshua. On the last day, he would tell them, "I don't know who you are." Because though they were initially saved, they've actually backslid. They've actually apostatized. And not many would do it frontally, like the former brother who last week said he's no longer a Christian. Many will not do it frontally. Many will continue in business, continue in their religious business, making money, drawing crowd, be famous. And at the same time, because they are not disciples of Yeshua, they are going to perdition. So what then is the definition of a disciple? In plain language, a disciple is a Christian indeed. You see, don't believe the pseudo-kingdom gospel that said the word Christian is evil. No, Christian is a nickname, yes. But what was the nickname? At Antioch in Acts chapter 11, the people saw how some people lived amongst them. And they called them Christians. In other words, Christos, little Christos. What is Christian? What is Christ? Christ means the anointed one. That's the Greek word for the anointed one. Messiah, Hamashiach. And they looked at them, they called them little anointed ones. It's a good word. It's a badge of honor to be called one who is like your master. So a disciple is a Christian indeed. A man and brethren, is a difference between a nominal believer and a Christian. Anyone can claim to be a believer based on hearing the gospel and purport to believing in him. But the popular scripture people used to justify the cheap, shallow Christianity is in Romans chapter 10, 8 to 10. The word is nigh you, even in your mouth, the word of faith, which is me, that, you know, if anyone who believe in his heart, the Lord Yeshua, and confess with the tongue, and he is saved. Now, people use that to think that that's all you need to do. No, he's talking about the entrance into the kingdom. Believe in the heart, confess with the tongue, No difficulty. Why? The Lord wanted nobody to be with excuse. The problem is not that scripture. That scripture ushers you in. The issue is that people come in and instead of pressing forward, they remain static or they even go back. And the issue is a stuck term. And with that stuck term, they keep on, you know, making such a mockery of the faith. The Lord is calling us that we came into the kingdom by believing in the heart and confessing with the tongue. That's not the end. Yeshua is the propitiation for our sin, yes. But there is a dimension where he calls us to now go from believing on him to follow him. A disciple is a follower of Yeshua who walks after him and seeks to be more like him. As we said in the previous chapter, disciples are not fair weather, meal drinking believers, but rather saints who have allowed Holy Spirit and the Word to renew their minds, transform their hearts, and who become personal representatives of Yeshua through whom he continues his redemptive assignment in the earth realm. And that means a disciple is called to make disciples. So you can't say you're a disciple and you are unengaged, you are not involved. You are also not called to go build organization. You are called to make disciples. Whether you make them at place of work, make them in your neighborhood, make them in the coffee shop, make them in the restaurant, make them anywhere. It's not something you can limit to a building. It's a lifestyle. A lifestyle where you wear Yeshua as a cloak. A lifestyle where you share about his life that was given on the cross for you. And those who believe, they come in. If they believe, then you begin to walk on them to get them to where you are and even possibly greater than where you are. There are two dimensions of discipleship. And those two dimensions are the instantaneous. The one that happens the day you realize that your life is not about what you own or not own. It's not about yourself. The day you realize that it's a cheap life if all you're doing is going to church to get that miracle, to get God to do this for you, to get that. If that is all, the day your eyes are open and you yearn for more and you cast yourself upon him and ask the Lord to do a work in you and take away. And what will happen? The day you realize that the biggest danger you face is not outside, is not an enemy. There's an enemy called self that is sitting at the throne of your heart. The day you identify that reality and you consciously eject self from the throne of your heart and then submit to the sovereign, open your heart for Yeshua to now come in and sit on the throne of your heart and to exercise sovereign rule over your life, meaning your life is no longer your own. He determines what you do, what you say. He determines where you go. When you come to that place of that kind of relationship, quality of relationship with him, where you have given up all, men and brethren, that's what he was telling his disciples in Matthew chapter 16. Then said Yeshua unto his disciples, if any man will come after me, they've been following him, but he said, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it. And whoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. For what is a man profited? He shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul. Or what shall a man give in exchange of his soul? When you come to the place where you are no longer driven by your ambition, by what you want to have, what you want to acquire, you are no longer driven by the things that rule the world system, what you think, what you say, what you see, and you are no longer driven by those passions. A lot of people's life is scattered because of multitude of lust they have. Lust for this, lust for that, lust for this, lust for that. And those things are scattering their life. They can't settle. The Lord is saying, you know what? The time has come to take away all those lusts, all those things that have filled your heart and your mind, to receive only one Lord, Yeshua HaMashiach, to be the king over you, to be the Lord over your life, to be the one ruling you, the one moving you, the one whose decision takes care of everything. So it's an experiential encounter with him that drives you to this place. I want to ask you, since you believe, have you ever come to this place? If you came to this place 7 years ago, 3 years ago, where are you now? Are you filled with so many lost things, so many things you are looking for? Do you know the beauty or the blessedness of owning nothing but him? Now, when you own nothing but him, you actually own all. But then you won't clutch at them. They don't dominate your consciousness because he dominates your consciousness. He is so enthroned in you. Men and brethren, that's the first dimension. The second dimension And listen to this. For that to happen, Galatians 2:20, I am crucified with Yeshua. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Yeshua liveth in me. The life which I now live, I live by the faith of the Son of Elohim, who loved me and gave himself for me. You see, the devil wants to suggest to you that if you don't struggle for yourself, if you don't labor for yourself and sweat for yourself, you are going to go hungry, you are going to go poor, you won't take care of your children, and a lot of people are burning their candles at two ends. No rest, no peace, no quiet, and they are just worried and anxious, and they are running pillar to post and looking for that miracle. The Father said, the day will come when your life is no longer about chasing miracle or miracle workers or chasing men of God. The day you make the transition to chase one person, Yeshua HaMashiach, to apprehend him and to come to that place where he's all in all, and you have opened your heart, he dwells there, and you don't care what man shall do unto you. That is the dramatic encounter of discipleship. The second dimension is the pressing in. You don't rest on your words. You say, well, hey, 3 years ago, I used to be so passionate. I've spent this number of time in prayer. I've spent this number of time in evangelism. What of today? You know what? A true disciple, you know the danger of resting. You know the danger of staying at one place. You know the danger of running around in circles. A true disciple knows it's a danger to the soul. And so for that reason, a true disciple must press on. Must press on the upward way. You check up your attitude. What are you clutching at? What are you clutching at? Name, fame, you know, at times people want to be known. I did this, I did that. You know what? You come to the place where all the glory goes to the Father. You don't care. Even when people are competing what you did and they want to compete that they did it, leave it to them. Because a true disciple is not after who recognizes him. True disciples who do great and mighty things, you wouldn't even know half of the things they did. You are not struggling with anybody. True disciples, when you come to the place where you are growing, money no longer rules you. It no longer dominates your consciousness, because faith in him is the greatest currency. Faith is the currency of the kingdom. When your heart is full of faith in him and trust in him, you can literally face any tomorrow. You know that whatever the Lord wants to do with you, through you, he will accomplish it. All you need to say is, yes, Lord. That process-based, continuous discipleship, it takes us progressively. We know where we were today. And then in the next 3 months, we're able to know and see progress we have made. That's what Paul said in Philippians chapter 3. But what things were gained to me, verse 7, I counted loss for Yeshua. Yea, doubtless, I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Yeshua, my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, that I may win Yeshua. When you are in this way, you don't hold anything tight-fistedly. You hold things with an empty hand. And if by any chance the wind takes them off, you are not destabilized. I count all things but dung. I don't clutch at anything. Why? He says, and be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which was of law, but that which is through the faith of Yeshua, the righteousness which is of Elohim by faith, that I may know him. Paul had known Yeshua for years. This was actually towards the end of his life. Yet he was saying that I may know him. Why? Because there's a dimension of discipleship that is present continuous until we see him in glory. That I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering. When you are pressing in, the things we suffer are no longer oppressive. We know that each one takes away some dross. Whether it's evil speaking, people rise against you. You bless people, they bite your hand. You give it over to him. You allow no pain to you. You bless those that curse you. You give them water to drink. You give them food. You are at this stage. It takes grace. It takes grace, but it's possible. It's doable. The problem is today that most of us have filled ourselves with worldly dogma and doctrines. We've read so much books. We watch television. Psychologists have told us things. From the time people are young, they are told, don't let anybody talk you down. Don't let anybody. So we begin to stand for your rights from primary school, even from kindergarten. So Christians of this generation are in danger that they've imbibed worldly culture that decries meekness, worldly culture that decries ability to let go. Yeshua said, if somebody wants the outer coat, give him the inner one also. People, you know what? The culture of the world is opposite the culture of the kingdom. Paul said that I may know him I want to have fellowship of his suffering. I want to be made conformable to his death. I want to die to self to the day that nothing moves me. If by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead. Not as though I already attained. Neither were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that for which I'm apprehended of Yeshua. Brethren, he says, I count not myself to have apprehended. But this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of Elohim in Yeshua. This is the continuous discipleship. And the Father is asking us from time to time, check up our attitude to things of this world. Check up. Are we able to, for instance, bless people with quality things? Or is it just, you know, the things we don't need? Is it just what we can give people? Are we able to sow a seed of value if the Lord tells us to do so? Are we able to love people in spite of, not because of? We know we come to that place where we see from the inside of us whether we are making progress. And if we see any area where we seem to have slackened, or we seem to have slowed down, we yearn for him. We're not looking at other people. A true disciple is not looking at other people. A true disciple is pressing in and pressing in and pressing in. Men and brethren, this is a call of the now. The Lord is looking for disciples. If there's one thing the Lord is looking for today, it is true disciples who will represent him. And I'll need to issue a caveat right now. This message and this teaching is not about asking people to resign their businesses to go into full-time ministry. As some religious people teach, discipleship is not that. You can resign your business and you're not a disciple. Listen, nobody forces anybody. When it comes to leaving your job or business, it's between you and Elohim. He knows what he wants to do with you. What we're saying is this. You can be full-time and yet you're not a disciple. You can be in full-time employment and yet you're a disciple. A disciple is a follower. One whose life mirrors his master. One whose life points people to him. One whose life makes people yearn to know Yeshua. And so, men and brethren, it's not about physical things or whatever. It's about a lifestyle change, a transformation, coming to the place where you have confidence in him that he can take care of you better. And I pray the Lord will help you. As we get into this course, the question is this. If not you, who is the Father calling to be a disciple? And if not now, when are you going to respond to that call? May today be that day for you. Why? The gates of grace are open now. Whenever the word of the Father comes this way, there is open gates of grace for you to press in without struggle. All he needs of you is your heart. Say, my son, give me your heart. Will you surrender your heart to him right now? Or are you going to withhold and say, no, not today. You almost persuaded me. Oh, give me some 20 days, 30 days. Oh, let me finish that contract. Let me finish that business. Let me finish that crusade I want to do before I can hear you. Is that your response? Are you like Agrippa? Are you like Festus? Are you like people in the Bible who were very close to things of the kingdom? Are you satisfied with rising and falling, flip-flopping? Do you want to remain where you were? Or are you ready to take a plunge into the pool of the blood today? So the assignments for today, please present a precise summary of the two pillars of the dead religious system. We talked about it at the beginning of this lesson. And they give a definition. What is the definition of discipleship you have learned from this chapter? You know what, men and brethren? Tell us how you expect the two dimensions of discipleship, an act and a process, how you can further your walk with the Lord. But I want to ask you, if not now, when will you respond to the call to be a disciple? Are you bouncing it off to another person? Can we pray with you before we take the announcements for today? Father in heaven, when your word comes forth like this, you have a plan and a purpose. Your hands are wide open to receive as many as will willingly surrender, and you will supply grace for them to experience the blessed state of discipleship. Father, I pray it right now, as we're about to pray for the people, as many as are responding, receive them, O Lord. Now, can you say with me, wherever you are now, Father in heaven, in the name of Yeshua, Jesus, I have walked my walk alone. I have been busy with trying to get things from you. Today I hear your voice. Lord, I release my heart to you. I open my heart. I eject self from my heart. And I ask Yeshua, come and be enthroned as the King of my life, as the Lord of my life. From today, take over. Renew my mind with your word. And draw me to that intimate place with you. From today, make me your disciple. Uphold me with your right hand of righteousness. Thank you, Father, for I know it's your good pleasure to make me your disciple. I surrender now in Yeshua's name. If that is your decision, Father, you heard them. Seal their confession with the blood. Draw them to yourself. Let Yeshua be enthroned in their heart and remain there all through. Nothing taken away from his dominance over their life. From today, self is crucified. Thank you for answering this prayer. We know you have made disciples of people across the nations today. Let each one be a catalyst to make more disciples, to take this gospel, this message forward. In Yeshua's name, amen. Brothers and sisters, listen to this. The Bible says in Psalm 68, verse 11, the Lord gives the word. Great is the company that publishes it. I want to ask you, every single day, publish this word. Release it. Every single day, publish it. When the teachings come, please share it widely. Share it in inbox to some of your very close friends and family. Share it also outbox. Share it on the timeline of people. Share in groups where you have permission. Talk to the administrators of groups you belong to and say, you know what, can I supply you resources, video resources? And they will say no. Amen. And be a partaker. And then within your loop of influence, look for other Christians and invite them to encounter him and become disciples. Amen. Now listen, from tomorrow, when the principal officers and mentors will be teaching, they'll be teaching on Daybreak with the King, the conference call line. We'd like you all to get on the conference call line and be part of it. If it's possible for us, because there are many people who cannot get on conference call line from various nations, if it's possible for me to find an hour or so each day from where we are to broadcast, I'll do so just for the benefit of those across the world. And you can also have the tape. And I tell you, our teachers are powerful. Listening to the audio, if you can call, if you're in the U.S. and many of the countries, 33 countries, you can call into that line. And if you reach out and ask the question, it will be answered you and the line will be given to you. Amen? Okay, now, we want to say this. There are a few bad days today. One of them is our sister Monica Nkando. Monica Nkando and her husband, Evangelist Steve Nkando, they are the IMF South Africa Director of Business, Professional and Public Affairs. A wonderful couple. They are part of the younger generation of Christians, of professionals who the Lord has brought into IMF, and they have stepped up the plate. They are taking responsibility. They are doing a beautiful work. Listen, the Father is using them, Malawi, Swaziland, and they brought the King, they brought extended IMF there, Zambia last year. The Lord used them, and this year they are supporting the church in Botswana, IMF in Botswana, Tanzania, and even DRC. So today is the birthday of Minister Monica Nkando. Please wish her happy birthday and greet people like that who are laboring within the network. Today also is the birthday of Henry Onyewuchi Naji, you know, one of my cousins. Today's birthday, and Pastor Faith Bankole of Ireland. Today's birthday. And our brother Bright to see we're here in the UK. And by the grace of the Lord, yesterday was 17th anniversary of World Fountain Christian Ministries. You know, Pastor Dupe Adefala, president of IMF UK, you know, the Father used her and a few people to start this ministry 17 years ago at a time when religious people said, women, who are women to do church, who are women to lead church. The Father gave her grace to persist grace to press in. And today we see what fountain, a wonderful expression of God's grace and glory in Oxford, the academic capital of the United Kingdom. And the Father is using a good work, empowering people, you know, in that ministry. The Father can use anyone. And so we thank the Father for that. Brothers and sisters, it's wonderful. And you know what? If the Father gives us permission, we are going to stream from wherever we are. Otherwise, please tune in to Daybreak with the King, same time on conference call line, and hear the mentors and principal officers who will be teaching this course. And Thursday next week, we'll resume. Have a blessed day. The Father bless you. Thank you, elect, for being with us on this line. Amen.